Good morning. Oh, it's wonderful to be here, isn't it? It's wonderful to have the music filling the spaces. It's wonderful to see the faces of people around this morning. You've been missed. We've missed each other. We've connected in various ways, in different ways, but it is nice to be here today. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of this land on which we meet today, the people of the Kaurna Nation, and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. And I would encourage us to welcome each other throughout our service and fellowship today. Also like to give thanks to the video technicians. We tried it and fortunately with God's grace we had some people who knew what they were doing, and when they didn't, they knew where to find out how to do what we were going to do, and it worked. And today you'll notice we've got the videoing of our service today. Don't worry, the video camera's going to stay there. It's not going to come around and see your face. It's mainly backs of heads. But this is an opportunity for those who are unable to worship with us this morning, and we'll continue and explore what that's going to look like, and that might change in the weeks as we go on. It's good that, as I mentioned, we've got Tony on the organ, and he will be filling the spaces in our church today. So when we do come to the hymns, the words will be up on the screen, but I'd invite you to remain seated. And I'd encourage you to reflect on the words. If you do want to sing, I'd suggest that you sing quietly just reflectively, because we are trying to do the right thing and keep social distancing, and to let out a joyful praise could have some ramifications. You notice that everyone had to sign in today and we had to sanitize and all those sorts of things. It's the new normal for the way that we proceed as much as we know it. And so we would just ask that we would respect each other and that we follow the requirements for the time being. So the words will be there, it's some great music, and I'd encourage you just to reflect on those words and to participate in a more refined way rather than standing up and letting it all go. We're going to have an opportunity to share in fellowship after the service, we are going to be meeting out in the back hall. There won't be any tea or coffee or biscuits, and we'd ask that you, as you engage in conversation, that you continue to be aware of the distancing to be fair and respectful of each other, which also means that when we leave the hall, be aware that we've got a little bottleneck there. Technically, we can only have seven people at a time in the foyer. So let's just reflect and take our time as we would go from one place to the other. You may have heard a couple of video services ago that we congratulated Elizabeth on her engagement. We did mention her fiancé's name, David, David Usa, and David is actually here today, and so we would welcome David in our fellowship this morning. And we wish David and Elizabeth every blessing as they work through the process, as they would look to organise their wedding and their life together following that. You'll notice that we've got a grapevine, thanks to Christine, there's some things that are happening on, and the prayer group has started. There's a study group that's meeting Monday night fortnightly, community care is up and running again, and fellowship is having a snack and chat, so bring your own lunch on Wednesday, July 22. We're still sorting out how we're going to do the hot beverages, so we need to be aware of that, but it'll be lovely for the ladies to get together for fellowship. I think that's pretty much all the announcements that I had, unless somebody can think of something. No, church council are meeting on Thursday night, and we're looking to find ways in which God can inspire us as the people of God to continue in our worship and fellowship and our ministry here in this area. Our call to worship will be a video, a song by Amy Grant that brings to us the words from Psalm 119. Remain seated as we reflect on these words this morning. So let us respond with the words on the screen. We bring our hopes and fears, our struggles and our lives as they are, into the presence of the one who leaves the doors and futures open to gracious possibilities. God's word lights the path before us. May this time of worship empower us to make faithful choices. God's word lights the paths before us. May this time of worship renew and restore our relationships with God and each other. God's word lights the paths before us. Come, let us worship.
Thank you. Jesus. Let's pray.
Abundant God, use our senses to open our hearts and minds to the richness of Scriptures. Help us to receive the gifts you sow so graciously and freely in our lives, and inspire us to share such bounty generously with our neighbours. Amen. And as we come to our prayer of confession, we think of current news items where division is causing unrest, wars, persecution, and unhappiness. How might we lead lives that disrupt injustice and open space for God's love to enter the world? And during this time, there'll be some times of silence when you can reflect on situations that you can think of. For hatreds between peoples, for violence among nations, and for breakdowns in society, we pray. Why does it have to be this way, God? What choices of ours could bring change? For unhappiness within families, for tensions among neighbours, we pray. Why does it have to be this way, God? What choices of ours could bring change? For divisions in the Christian Church and other peoples of faith, for conflict within our community, we pray. Why does it have to be this way, God? What choices of ours could bring change? We bring this before you, Lord, and pray that you'll change our hearts to reflect on what we've been praying about. Amen. The words of affirmation. Hear the promise of God. Through all these times, amidst all his conditions, God offers the Spirit's transformative power for our companion, guide, and hope. Thanks be to God.
first reading is the reading from Psalm 119, verses 105 to 112. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I inclined my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. And a second reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 11, life in the Spirit. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the Spirit that dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, this is a bit different.
Over the past journey of faith, and they disciplined themselves to obey God. They were committed, focused, devout, upright, good, righteous men. We've kind of painted them to be the baddies after what they did to Jesus and after they misinterpreted what Jesus was saying. Because we never do that, do we? It's easy for us to say, oh, they were the bad ones. We are never like those. And yet they were the good guys. They were the ones who sought through their determination, through their commitment to following God, to do the best that they could. And they wished to emulate this law and this righteousness throughout their lives. They lived, Saul lived, knowing that not everyone could achieve this. It was only the best. And so there was a desperation and a determination to be the best that you could to serve this God. To follow God was to choose the best way. Now, I don't know about you, but as I was growing up, I served this God in a church that, yeah, knew Jesus, but I grew to serve this God who was demanding, this God who was righteous. And so I sought to live my life, to do the best that I could to impress this God, to earn his favor. Even though I knew of Jesus, there was still a determination that not everybody was going to make it, and I had to do the best that I could. I was living under law, not grace, even though I knew the vocabulary, even though I was born in a Christian home. I really had no option. I was going to be Christian whether I liked it or not, because I grew up in a Christian home. Yeah, I made some choices along the way, and I did come to an understanding of Jesus through God's salvation expressed through Jesus. So I did make a choice. But then I fell back into that process of my God was Jehovah, a holy, demanding, patient God, benevolent, but only if you did the right thing. And if you stuffed up, well, you had to go back and say sorry, and then you could try again. But again, trying harder and harder to obey the law and to keep the law. I found that I did experience a conversion, but my conversion was a part of many conversions over many, many years as I learnt to see more clearly what God and what Jesus was all about. Now, the God Jehovah is not a bad God. It's just not the whole picture. It's not a wrong understanding of God, but it isn't God in God's entirety. Saul became Paul when he met Jesus. And so the God of Jesus was Jehovah? Yes, and. For we find that Jesus introduces us. The God in Jesus' story is Abba, not the Swedish music group, but Abba, a Hebrew word meaning father, or more intimately, daddy. The God of Jesus is a loving parent, a welcoming God. Jesus reminds us, as we heard last week, that his yoke is easy. It's not anything goes, but there is freedom involved in this serving of God. The God of Jesus is more open, generous, trusting, loving, vulnerable. And this way is the best way. And everyone can do this. Not only the best, but everyone can do it because it's an invitational, relational God. It's not under law, but under grace. And as you reflect on those words from Romans chapter 8, you can get lost, particularly as some of the versions would talk about the law and the flesh and and the spirit and grace. The reality is that at the background, who is the God that you are hearing this through? What eyes are you looking at it? Are you looking at a God who is judgmental and a God who is keen for you to do the right thing, but lo and behold, if you do the wrong thing, there's some punishment out there? Or are you reflecting and reading these words from Romans chapter 8 as Paul is struggling to try and deal with his understanding of God transformed through Jesus? The law is not necessarily wrong or bad, but it's not enough, for there is a better way. And grace gives us many options and many connections. I said I was born a Christian. I grew up in a Christian home. I did the right things. I had to come to a term of understanding in my own life to say, yes, I get this, and this is the path that I choose to follow. And then I set out on that path and looked to find more ways to serve my God. And in spite of that, God spoke to me through experiences often I didn't hear. And there were many wasted opportunities. And yet every now and again, some things happened along the way. I remember in 2000, the year 2000, I went to a weekend, an Emmaus weekend, where people spoke to me of God's love and grace, and suddenly something began to melt through the facade that I had and my understanding of law. And I got to see that there was generosity and grace and goodness in God's love expressed through the lives of other people. There still was some catches, because then you were invited to join a community and then you had to keep going and keep serving. from that understanding of God's grace in my life, I found myself in theological college. And in 2002, I was sitting down in a lecture on spirit and faith. And because at that stage, the college shared lectures with the Anglicans, the Catholics, and the Uniting Church, there was a Catholic priest who was teaching. And I came across a gentleman called Karl Rahner, who's a Catholic theologian, somebody who is wise and spends a lot of time writing words about God. But in the midst of all of that, I had another aha moment and saw that I was loved even in my brokenness. From that, there has been a journey continuing on, finding more, and even this year, in the midst of the lockdown and the coronavirus and what's happening, there's been aha moments as I've paused and reflected and seen that God is active in my brokenness, in my sinfulness, in my desire that God still is living intimately as part of my life and my journey. I've been on a journey for many, many years, and somehow God has been faithful with me as I've continued to try and find my path forward. And I'm sure in your own life you would reflect and see that there's been times when you've seen things differently, that somehow there's a bigger picture, and like Saul and like Malcolm, you have experienced something of a challenge where there's an opportunity for you to accept, to step forward, to live out, to give it a try, to find that there are new opportunities and that this understanding of Jesus is bigger than you ever, ever imagined. It's called growing. It's called being part of God's family. For this God of Jesus opens us up to the realization that we're all in this together. And it's not just the lucky few that make it in there, that somehow God's invitation is for all people. I grew up in this Old Testament understanding of God, even with Jesus, and saw that things were black and white, that things were right or wrong, and I fashioned my life on that duality. And yet I've begun to see that Jesus opens up and says that that's not necessarily wrong, but it is a starting point. And there are more options. There is more wisdom in God through Jesus. For God gives to us the whole picture. We find that when we break it into the law and we try to find out who's in and who's out, who's right and who's wrong, we find that it's limiting. It's not enough for the gospel. And the gospel ends up suffocating when we live under law. It's only when we recognize grace and God's goodness and God's intimacy, the truth that God lives with you, that God is present in your life, not just when we're here in church, not just when we're listening to beautiful organ music, not just when we're all smiling and sitting together in the church, but in the midst of our day-to-day activities, in the struggles, in the celebrations, in those late night, early morning times when you're awake and you question and you wonder, or you ache and you struggle and you can't find the answers. God is present even there in those situations. I've been here for 12 months now. And you might think, well, I've heard this before. This guy keeps going on and on and on and on and on. But maybe that's because it is part of the truth of the gospel. That the essence of our journey is to see that we are not under law, but we are under grace. And that God is intimate and personally engaged in our life. That's the God in my story. That's the God who desires to be close and relational, and that I see myself not just as an individual, not just as a member of a group who belong to this church, but part of a wider community who are all on the track together, all with their different understandings. And it's good once a week to pause and reflect on God's word and listen to the babbling words of the minister. But what do we do with that? How do we live that out in the other days? What are the practical tips from the story of God in our life? How do you live it out, and how does that impact on your actions? You've got $20. You've got $50 cash. The law would say you have to give 10% of that to the church, and then you may use the other 90% for life for yourself. Is that how you reflect on the resources that you have? Your money, your time, your resources? How do you give that? Is it enough to put it in an envelope or to put it in the box? Or do you find that you actually engage in sharing and talking to people who might be beneficiaries of that resource? We see homeless people on the streets, and if you have been out and around, they are still there. They're not always in the hotels that the government provides. Do you share time with them? Do you engage in conversation with them? We've been encouraged to support local business, cafes and supermarkets in our area, to continue to keep our economy flowing. Do we do that, get our groceries and then leave, or do we engage with the people that are there? Those of you who know me know that I like a skinny flat white. And I've been going to a couple of coffee shops regularly and purchasing a coffee and spending time with those people. And they know who I am. They know that I'm a Christian. They know that I go to church. I even told them I'm a minister. And they still talk to me. I've learnt next door at the No Harm Done cafe, where it's all plant-based and dairy-free, that I've engaged in oat milk flat white and a soy flat white. And the young gentleman who's managing there, we've had some conversations. His faith base is certainly not mine, but it's been part of sharing and recognising that I am interested in his life. And I'm not about to try and drag him into church, but to show some concern and some reality that there is grace and opportunity. So as we think about the fact that we are not under law but grace, are you just going to let that sit there over the next hour and a half and then maybe get up tomorrow morning and think, now what am I going to do? Or will you allow this to touch your life in practical realities day to day to day? I can preach all I like, but really, you're the ones who live your lives. Who is the God that you are living with? And how does God influence you? And how are you trying to impress God? And what things are you doing in your community? How can you change? And what answers to the question of what will I do, will you be able to say, so that your life this week can contain an aha moment where maybe you see things a little differently and maybe the light on your path shows a little brighter, so that you may see something more of what God is seeking for you to be. Not so that you can get out of trouble, but that's so that you can respond to the truth that God's Spirit lives in you and that you are motivated by grace, not by law. Does that make sense? I've got some nods. Okay. We'll take those. And may this week you engage in recognizing that God is present, that God seeks to bless you and those around you. And may you be involved in doing and living the truth of the gospel. As we remain seated, I'd invite us to reflect on the words from TIS 555, put all your trust in God.
So just a word of thanks to the faithful and committed givers in our congregation who've continued to contribute your weekly offering in various ways. So today there is provision in the entrance area just as you came in. There's a box there if you have your offering and would like to place it in it. If you have any problems or want to discuss how you might use the various methods of offering, please see Robert Backhouse, who our treasurer, who will talk to you about possibilities. And so I thought I'd just offer a prayer now of dedication to for offerings for the last several months and for today. So let's pray. Gracious God, may the gifts we freely offer be without expectation for anything in return. And may you bless the work of these gifts this day and in the days ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now to our prayers of the people. At this time, we bring people and situations before you, Lord, and we'll be particularly thinking of the people in Victoria, because I'm sure most of us have someone we know in Victoria and Melbourne, and we just think about what's going on in there, and maybe just understand that we just have to continue doing what we're doing because we don't want that for here. But we remember those people, so let's pray. God of each of us and God of all of us, we pray for our families, those with whom we are drawn together by birth, by marriage, or by adoption. And may they receive care and love from you and from us as well. We pray for our friends and neighbours, those with whom we are drawn together by common places of work or learning or fellowship, by common aspirations and values. May we strengthen the ties between us, and may we find in these relationships the freedom and companionship and community that nurture us and the world around us. We pray for our fellow citizens, those with whom we are drawn together by birthplace and nation, from all countries of the world who make up our Australia and the First Peoples of our nation. Fashion these bonds to ensure the relationships and ideas we claim are paid more than lip service. And today particularly, we pray for all those who are affected by the COVID virus worldwide, and particularly in Melbourne and Victoria. May all the decision makers, the medical advisers, the police and security people work together to help and care for all. We pray for those who are sick, for the medical profession and the nursing people who look after them, and for their families who may be isolated from them and not able to care for them. We pray for those who are part of this community and the whole Christian Church, those with whom we are drawn together by a common faith and an uncommon grace. May we thrive in ministry, may we expand in mission, and may we deepen in spirituality, and may we all grow closer to one another and you. Free us to recognise the stranger as no stranger, but sister and brother, and to see the joy and need of any as the cause of our rejoicing and compassion. We bring these prayers to you, Jesus. Amen. And we just share the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And our going out song is a wonderful song, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Thank you so much for sharing in worship with us today. We have been videoing it, as I said. How can people access it? Will it go up on our webpage or on YouTube? On YouTube. So it's sort of like what we used to do. So if you know of someone who wasn't here this morning, or if you want to tell some of your friends that we videoed the service, that's the best way to direct them to, so that they can look at it. Or you might just want to go to church during the week and click on it again and relive some of what we had this morning. The light of God is in our lives. We've got a candle. It's just one candle. It's not as hot as those ones up there, nor the spotlights that we might see in some of the dramatic presentations. Remember when we used to go to the cinema or theatre? Yeah, a long time ago. but just an ordinary light or a match. This week is going to be an ordinary week. You're going to do ordinary things, boring things. You might do something interesting, but the reality is that God's light is within you. And we've talked about shine, Jesus, and fill this land with your Father's glory, and blaze, Spirit, blaze. Well, go for it in the ordinary days of your life. May you know that you are not under law but under grace to be able to do and be who God created you to be in the small things on Monday, on Tuesday afternoon at 3 o'clock, on Wednesday morning at 10:30, all through the week and all those crazy times. Be God's person and share God's love and open the world to the truth that God lives within you. Go in God's name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.